Welcome to St. Paul's Online Service. I'm Pastor Cindy Austin. Just a few announcements before we begin. The first is we are excited for David Reby, a former member of St. Paul's, who will be ordained on September 19th at 2 o'clock at Christ Our Savior Lutheran in Sussex, Wisconsin. He has been called to be the pastor at Redemption Lutheran in Wauwatosa. Please keep David and Patty in your prayers as they begin their ministry up there. And we are doing our council installation today. Last month at our annual meeting, we elected the new St. Paul's Church Council. We have Matthew Johnson, who is president, Mary Lee Unrath, vice president, Pat Demas, treasurer, and Nancy Granger as secretary. And the remaining council members are Jan Duncan, Ruby Gloglovsky, Janet Hogan, Gordy Johnson, and Dean Knutson. For those council members who are worshiping at home, this is your installation. You have been elected as members of the St. Paul's Lutheran Church Council and are now ready to work together for the work of building God's kingdom. You're responsible to see that all our worship services are in good order. You are responsible for Sunday school, Bible classes, and all the other classes in the church. You're responsible for the monies and the repair of our church building and all other things. You're responsible to help, to visit the sick and the poor, to keep peace in our congregation, and help support Christ's kingdom in our church, our world. You have been called by Christ to serve this community, and so I now ask you, are you ready to declare your intention to serve as officers of this congregation? Will you do your work to the best of your ability, following the call of Christ, as revealed through the Bible, as well as our constitution of the congregation? If so, please answer yes with the help of God. I now declare you members of the St. Paul's Lutheran Church Council. May the Lord bless you and keep you through His Holy Spirit. May God advise you and give you strength in your work. God encourage you to work good for the congregation, to grow through your hard work. Thank you for your willingness to serve. We now continue with the brief order for confession and forgiveness. God of all mercy and consolation, give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our faith and our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your heart and in faith. Amen.
Assurance. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Now face a mission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, I'm happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, trusting His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, enliven and preserve your church. With your perpetual mercy, without your help, we mortals will fail. Remove far from us everything that is harmful, and lead us toward all that gives life and salvation, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from the 13th chapter of Romans, beginning with the 8th verse. Owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves one another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not commit murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in the reveling and drunkenness, not in the debauchery and licentiousness, not in the quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Here ends the reading.
The Holy Gospel is from the 18th chapter of Matthew, beginning with the 15th verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, if another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Strong and violent, but faithful.
Let us pray. Prepare our hearts, Lord, to receive your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so that by hearing we may believe, and by believing we may obey your will. Reveal to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I have to confess that in the past I've spent way too much time on Facebook. Nowadays, not so much. It breaks my heart to read comments. I think of one person who loves to post things really controversial, then just sits back and lets people argue over it. Steve calls it throwing out chum. Chum, you know, is that food that draws shark, and then you watch the feeding frenzy. And if you spend any time on social media, there's so much anger, so much hatred, so much fear behind it all. Sometimes I feel like we all have been put in a competition. We want our side to win at all costs, and we'll do and say anything to make sure that we win. But life is not a competition. In the gospel for today, Jesus talks about how we have to deal with one another, and that this is the process that we've used in the church to excommunicate people. If someone sins against you, go and talk with them. If they still don't agree with you, bring in a couple others. If they still go against you, then bring them in front of the church. And if they still don't agree, then, as Jesus says, treat them as a Gentile or tax collector. Now that's the interesting part. I've always understood that, especially in the light of excommunicating someone or throwing them out of the church, that is what you are supposed to do. I've talked with a couple people over the years who were actually excommunicated from other churches and told that they could not enter the church they had attended anymore. But how did Jesus treat the Gentiles or the tax collectors? Think about that. How did he treat them? Jesus ate and drank and talked with them. Because as the Apostle Paul says in the letter to Romans, that all these laws that a good person follows, honor your father and mother, do not kill, do not commit adultery, do not steal, speak well of your neighbor, all of these things can be summed up as one. Love your neighbor. Love your neighbor. Our son John loves to show us different YouTube videos, and they run through a range of things. This week he showed us a TED Talk given by Daryl Davis, and I had never heard this story before, and if you get a chance, watch his TED Talk. But I want to tell you today this story. Daryl Davis is a 62-year-old American blues and R&B musician. And he plays a mean piano. Amazing. Oh yes, he's also black. Years ago, back when he was 25, he was playing a music at a bar called the Silver Dollar with a band. And a white gentleman approached him and said, "I really enjoy y'all's music." Davis thanked him, shook the man's hand, and then the man said, "You know, this is the first time I ever heard a black man play piano like Jerry Lee Lewis." Davis later said he was surprised that this guy didn't know the origin of that kind of music. Davis said, "Well, where do you think Jerry Lee Lewis learned how to play that kind of style?" Guy said, "I don't know." Davis said he learned it from the same place I did. Black blues and boogie-woogie piano players. That's what the rockabilly, rock and roll style came from. And the guy said, "No, Jerry Lee invented that. I ain't ever heard no black man except you play like that." And Davis said he thought to himself, "This guy's never heard of Fats Domino or Little Richard." Then the guy said, "You know, this is the first time I ever sat down and had a drink with a black man." Well, by now, Davis was curious. He thought, how come in his 25 years, He's sat down with literally thousands of white people for a drink or to eat or to sit and talk. And this guy, who was about 15 to 20 years older, had never sat down with a black guy before. And Davis said, well, how come? How come? At first, the guy didn't answer. Finally, the guy's friend elbowed him and said, tell him, tell him, tell him. And the guy finally said, I'm a member of the Ku Klux Klan. Davis said he started laughing. He couldn't believe that this guy was KKK, and he thought he was joking. But as Davis was laughing, the guy pulled out his wallet and handed him his Klan card. And immediately, Davis stopped laughing. This guy really was KKK. And Davis thought, why am I sitting by a Klansman? But the guy was friendly, and it was the music that brought them together. And he wanted Davis to call him and let him know any time he was at the bar with this band that a Klansman would sit down with a black man. And it got to Davis thinking, how can you hate me when you don't even know me? And Davis thought, I want to be able to find that out and write a book. So he began to contact KKK members. One of Davis's first and foremost fabled contacts was with the Grand Dragon, Robert Kelly, who eventually became the Imperial Wizard of Maryland. Davis had his secretary set up a meeting with Kelly under the pretense of including him in a book about the KKK, and he told his secretary, don't let Kelly know he was black. If she was asked, don't lie, but don't offer that. And when Kelly walked into the room with his bodyguard, he was shocked that he was meeting with a black man. They were wary, but they went ahead with the meeting, and after a few tense hours of conversation, Davis and Kelly left, but they met again and again. Eventually, Kelly began inviting Davis to his home and then to Klan rallies where there were chants and giant crosses were burned and beer and hot dogs were served. Kelly shared everything with him, including the deeply racial stereotypes that would help form the foundation of the Klan's hatred. All the while, Davis listened, asked questions, took notes, and through his actions, slowly dispelled each stereotype one by one. With each conversation, the gap between them narrowed, and they were able to become friends. And finally, Kelly quit the Klan, shut down his entire chapter, and as a trophy of sorts, he gave his robe to Davis. Over these past years, over 200 individuals have left the Klan and turned their robes over to Daryl Davis. Daryl said, I never set out to convert anyone in the Klan. I just set out to get an answer to my question. How can you hate me when you don't even know me? But in my quest to befriend them, some of them ended up converting themselves. And he said it's a wonderful thing when you see a light bulb pop on in their heads and they call you and tell you they're quitting. I simply gave them a chance to get to know me and treat them the way I want to be treated. They come to their own conclusion that this ideology is no longer for them. It's all about relationships, getting to know one another, to hear the other person's story. Not to badger them, but to try and understand them. When Jesus talked about conflict, he was dealing with relationships. If there's a conflict, sit down and talk to that person. If it still doesn't help, bring in another. And that still doesn't work, then the church. Then if that still doesn't work, Jesus says, treat them like Gentiles and tax collectors. Then do as Jesus did. Or Daryl Davis did. Get to know them. Eat with them. Talk with them. And most importantly, as difficult as it is, love them as you have been loved. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. Lord, there's so much division, so much pain, so much fear and distrust. We pray for those who live each day in oppression and injustice. Let their pain and their voices be heard, and justice roll down like water. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who are struggling with health and mental health issues. Grant them your healing and your strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who serve as police, firefighters, first responders, and all who serve in the military. Their jobs are not easy and often very dangerous. We ask that you would guard and protect them, Lord. Grant them your patience and your peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for those who work in education, in our public schools, private schools, colleges, and universities. Be with their staffs, the administrations, the school boards, and be with all the students and their families, whether they meet remotely, in person, or by a hybrid. Grant them all a measure of your protection, patience, and grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who are serving at churches, secretaries, custodians, musicians, staff, and pastors, and of course, volunteers. We are so thankful for those who have been chosen to serve as St. Paul's Church Council. Grant them all your patience, your wisdom, and grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we are called to live by faith, looking to you as our source of life and hope. Sometimes it's so difficult and we fail so much. But you welcome us back with forgiveness and love, and then send us out again. Let your light shine in our lives, and let us reflect your light and your love into this world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in hope, we lift our prayers to you, most gracious God, trusting that you have received them in your care. Amen.
Let us praise God together on our knees. Let us praise God together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun,
in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we are reminded that Christ is present in the midst of our fears, in the midst of our anger, in the midst of our despair, that Christ is there who offers his love and his forgiveness. The body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Stars, the rushing planets, sing to the Lord a new song. Heaven and rain, the rolling snows, sing to the Lord a new song. God has done marvelous things, I too sing praises with a new
peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Heaven knows God's love rushing.